Good evening. Hope you had a wonderful afternoon. Glad that you're here this evening to worship and celebrate with us. Let's stand as we prepare to worship this evening. Father, we pray your blessing upon our time together, that you would be honored. I pray that you would speak to us heart and soul this evening, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Now, this first song that we're going to do is kind of, it's not a round, but I'll sing and then you'll just sing and repeat after me until we get to the verse and we'll also, or the chorus, and then we'll sing all of that together. Things we could be doing with our voices, with our time, with our energy. What an honor it is to give it back to the Lord who gave us and gives us every sustaining breath that we have. Amen.
How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond our measure, that He should give His only Son to make a wretch His treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the Father turns His face away, as wounds which mar the chosen one bring many sons to glory. Mm-hmm.
So good for me to come to the Lord, to the house of the Lord tonight. Seems like, I don't know what your week's been like, but it's been a challenging one for me. So it's so nice to just take a few moments and worship the Lord, to sense His presence and His peace, and to worship with my friends. You. So please welcome those around you.
It has been good to see people rolling back in this evening, so we're glad to see them arriving. Just a couple more announcements. Let's see. This morning, during the 9:30 service, I butchered the announcement pretty good this morning concerning WOW and WeWow. Let's give it another shot.
You can do it.
Okay.
I believe you.
See. She's a real cheerleader, isn't she? Okay, let's see. Okay, Wow and We Wow begins this Wednesday, 6:45 to 8:15. They're going to be studying Genesis. And if you are first grade through sixth grade, or you have children first grade through sixth grade that want to quiz over the WOW material, please let Devon or the office know so that we can get the appropriate material ready for you. We have 26 children so far signed up. Do we have any more?
Not yet. I'm waiting on three that I think are going to.
Okay. Okay, did I do okay?
You did great. Didn't
you? Okay. Woohoo!
We are not very enthusiastic, are we?
Okay. Here is a more serious question. I want a show of hands. How many of you actually went in the restroom to watch the water swirl today?
I did. You invited us.
I see. I see a few hands. Okay, that's good. It's good to know that the restrooms are functioning again, and we're glad to see that taking place. Okay, could I have the ushers, please, for the celebration of our tithes and offerings? Woohoo, we have ushers. That's great. Luke chapter 6, verse 38. Give, and it will be given to you. A good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over, will be poured into your lap. For with the measure you use, it will be measured unto you. Father, we pray your blessing upon these tithes and offerings, that they would honor you. We offer them to you as a form of worship and celebration. We recognize that even in our giving of the gift, you have provided it. We thank you, Lord, and we worship you in this act. In Jesus' name, amen.
And I'll never know how much. So here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. And you're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. So here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. And you're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. So here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. And you're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. Jesus, my Redeemer, name above all names, precious Lamb of God, Messiah, oh, for sinners slain. Thank you.
Well, it's always comforting for us to know that we can come to an altar of prayer anytime we desire in the Westside Church. It doesn't make any difference what's taking place in the service. The altar is always open to you. But it is especially open during our concentrated time of prayer. And so if you have a special need that you'd like to represent today, I encourage you to come at this time. Lord, Master, I want to say thank you today. Thank you for not being a respecter of age. Thank you, Lord, for being hard after us our entire life. Never too old, never too young. Thank you, Lord, for loving us and caring for us. Lord, our heart grieves today for those that have faced tragedy just in the last day and a half. El Paso, Dayton, come to mind. We pray for those families, those communities. We pray for our own community, Lord. I pray for those, Lord, that we had opportunity to look into their eyes yesterday and see the anguish and the heartache. To look at them and to see how grateful they were. Just to receive your touch. I pray for them today, wherever they are. I pray, Lord, that they would be able to find you. Lord, I pray for Kathy today, Pastor Kathy, as she brings the message this evening. I know that she has poured her heart and soul out into the message. She's spent hours in preparation. She's spent time in prayer. And I know that all of this has taken place. I'm witness to it. I pray, Lord, that you would speak through her this evening. Whatever that means, Lord, whatever the message is that you desire to give to each one of us, I pray, Lord, that we would receive that message with gladness. I pray, Lord, that you would grant your special blessing upon her as she comes. And I pray, Father, for those that are kneeling at an altar of prayer and are lifting up specific needs before you, things of great concern, things of importance, of urgency, things that can't be tackled by anybody but you. But you are a great and mighty God. There is nothing that we bring to you that is beyond you. And your love for us is unending. And so we lay these concerns at your feet and ask for your assistance and ask for your wisdom that these prayers might be answered. We love you, Lord, and we trust in you this evening in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated.
Well, good evening. It's good to have some of our teens and their families back from a great weekend, I understand. God's always doing great things, isn't he? So tonight we're going to be looking at Peter and Cornelius's visions from the Lord found in Acts 10. It's really pretty amazing how God speaks to us in so many ways. He uses his holy word, which is the Bible, to talk to us and communicate with us. He talks to us in dreams and in visions, in times of prayer. He uses his Holy Spirit to speak to us. He uses other people. He uses his church and his creation among some of the most common ways to communicate with us. in the Bible, and specifically in Acts 2:17 and Joel 2:28, it says that God will pour out his spirit in the last days. Our sons and daughters will prophesy. Young men will see visions, and old men will dream dreams. Friends, we are in the last days. The Holy Spirit has come. He is here, and he is speaking to us. However, if we are not primed to listen, we will not hear him. God truly has something that he wants us to hear from him about every single day. So the question is, are we primed? Are we primed and ready to receive his message through visions, through dreams, through messages? He's sending them all the time to us. So the question, what does it mean to be primed? Let's look at the word prime, because it has several meanings. And the context that I'm using it in tonight, described by Merriam-Webster Dictionary, calls it an intransitive verb, which is a verb that does not require an object to be complete, but it can be applied to an object. So for tonight's focus, we are the object of the verb prime. And the definition of prime means to stimulate or prepare. For example, many pumps require priming before it can function correctly. So especially older pumps, if you wanted to get into a well, you had to prime it. Maybe you've seen some movies where they have to prime a well to get it to work. And so that's the kind of verb that we're looking at. Merriam-Webster offers an explanation of this word when used in this particular context. And it says that it means to take steps to encourage growth or function of something. So tonight, what I want us to do is to do a personal assessment on our prime condition. So we're going to begin by reading from Acts 10, verses 1 through 38. Let me get my glasses on. Okay. Let's pray, shall we? Father God, we thank you so much for your word. It is life-giving and teaches us so much, Lord. And so we thank you for it. We thank you for the power that you extend through it to us, Jesus. We love you, and we ask that you would help us to receive all that you have for us this evening. In your name we pray. Amen. Acts 10, beginning in verse 1. At Caesarea, there was a man named Cornelius, a centurion in what was known as the Italian regiment. He and all his family were devout and God-fearing. He gave generously to those in need and prayed to God regularly. One day at about 3 p.m, he had a vision. He distinctly saw an angel of God who came to him and said, "Cornelius." Cornelius stared at him in fear. "What is it, Lord?" he asked. The angel answered, "Your prayers and gifts to the poor have come up as a memorial offering before God. Now, send men to Joppa to bring back a man named Simon, who is called Peter. He is staying with Simon the tanner, whose house is by the sea." When the angel who spoke to him had gone, Cornelius called two of his servants and a devout soldier who was one of his attendants. He told them everything that had happened and sent them to Joppa. About noon the following day, as they were on their journey and approaching the city, Peter went up to the roof to pray. He became hungry and wanted something to eat. And while the meal was being prepared, he fell into a trance. He saw heaven opened and something like a large sheet being let down to earth by its four corners. It contained all kinds of four-footed animals, as well as reptiles of the earth and birds of the air. Then a voice told him, "Get up, Peter, kill and eat." "Surely not, Lord," Peter replied. "I have never eaten anything impure or unclean." The voice spoke to him a second time, "Do not call anything impure that God has made clean." This happened three times, and immediately the sheet was taken back to heaven. While Peter was wondering about the meaning of the vision, the men sent by Cornelius found out where Simon's house was and stopped at the gate. They called out, asking if Simon, who was known as Peter, was staying there. While Peter was still thinking about the vision, the Spirit said to him, "Simon, three men are looking for you, so get up and go downstairs. Do not hesitate to go with them, for I have sent them." Peter went down and said to the men, "I'm the one you're looking for. Why have you come?" The men replied, "We have come from Cornelius the centurion. He is a righteous and God-fearing man who is respected by all the Jewish people. A holy angel told him to have you come to his house so that he could hear what you have to say." Then Peter invited the men into the house to be his guests. The next day, Peter started out with them, and some of the brothers from Joppa went along. The following day, he arrived in Caesarea. Cornelius was expecting them and had called together his relatives and close friends. As Peter entered the house, Cornelius met him and fell at his feet in reverence. But Peter made him get up. "Stand up," he said. "I am only a man myself." Talking with him, Peter went inside and found a large gathering of people. He said to them, "You are well aware that it is against our law for a Jew to associate with a Gentile or visit him. But God has shown me that I should not call any man impure or unclean. So when I was sent for, I came without raising any objection. May I ask why you sent for me?" Cornelius answered, "Four days ago, I was in my house praying at this hour at 3 p.m. Suddenly, a man in shining clothes stood before me and said, 'Cornelius, God has heard your prayer and remembered your gifts to the poor. Send to Joppa for Simon, who is called Peter. He is a guest in the home of Simon the tanner, who lives by the sea.' So I sent for you immediately, and it was good of you to come. Now we are all here in the presence of God to listen to everything the Lord has commanded you to tell us." Then Peter began to speak. The children, we talked about this in church this morning, so some of you can be doing the motions as we do the scripture. "I now realize how true it is that God does not show favoritism, but accepts men from every nation who fear him and do what is right. You know the message God sent to the people of Israel, telling the good news of peace through Jesus Christ, who is Lord of all. You know what has happened throughout Judea, beginning in Galilee after the baptism that John preached, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and power, and how he went around doing good and healing all who were under the power of the devil, because God was with him." This is the word of the Lord. There's so much in this text. We went in a different direction in children's church this morning than we're going to go tonight. So if you were in children's church, you'll hear something new out of the same scripture this evening. But it's interesting that if Peter and Cornelius had not been primed to receive what the vision communicated, we might not be sitting here today. That vision changed everything. What was unclean, God deemed clean. Not just the animals, but that translated to the Gentiles. And so it really makes a difference on if we're hearing and receiving God's word or not. Since we are in the last days, we should be aware that visions and dreams and prophesying will increase in our time. They should be occurring more now than ever before in history. Isn't it interesting that it isn't talked about more in churches? And even more interestingly, it is that people will say, "Oh, man, back in the day, they really heard from God. I wish God spoke to us in the same way like he did back then." The truth is, He does. He is. So I think about that and I pray about that, and I can't help but consider that it might be because the church is trying to reach worldly people, and in her efforts to be relevant to the world, there's been some compromise on speaking about things that a lost world does not understand and often mocks or hates what it doesn't understand, which has consequently made the church less cognizant and less considerate of these significant works of God. These are miracles, friends. These are miracles that should be and are taking place every day in our lives as believers. In the church's efforts to be relative to the world that it's trying to reach, has she become out of touch on such matters herself? And if that is the case, should we recognize that the church would not be hearing from God the way that it should be? The church is distracted, maybe, on important things. It's important for us to share the gospel, but nonetheless, it is distracted. God says in Numbers 12:6 that if there is a prophet among you, God himself, he will reveal himself in a vision and speak through dreams. God says that he will reveal his secret to his servants, the prophets, in Amos 3:7. He also warns us in 1 John 4:1 to not believe every spirit, because there are many false prophets. We must be walking closely with him so we can discern true and false prophets. If we're not walking closely with Christ in constant communion with him, then we are open to many spirits, including the ruler of the spirits and the works of this world. How do we get and stay primed to hear the voice of and receive the messages of God? This is actually a fairly common question that we Christians have to field often. We hear that from new believers. We hear it from young believers, seekers, and skeptics. As a children's pastor for many, many years, that was something that I heard all the time, all the time. Like, you know, I would get, you hear from God? How do you hear from God? How do you know it's the voice of God? How can I hear the voice of God? What can I do to hear from God? And I'm sure that you have fielded the same question. It might be presented in different ways, but it's essentially the same question. So let's just take a practical approach to answer that question. When we want to find out about how something works, some things that we do include asking people who have experienced that which we're looking to find out about. So when I started working with farm animals, I wanted to talk to people who had experience, and specifically goats. I had a girlfriend who was a goat farmer, and so I would say, Nicole, talk to me about how this works. I still call Nicole when I run into things I have no idea about, because she has more experience than I do. So we explore that with people who have experience and can talk to the issue based on that. Then maybe we try it ourselves. The best way to figure something out is to dive right in. I'm sure you've encountered that. So kind of trial by error. And so we can try it ourselves and see how it works and tweak it as we need to. Another way that we tend to try to explore something we want to find out more about is we research. We do some research. We read about it. And truly, the Bible gives us accounts of people who wrote down their experiences or wrote down the experiences shared by others in this particular question or this matter. We also know these as testimonies or testaments. So if the people of the Bible had the technology and language that we have today, they might have been called declarations or notarized or sworn statements, and they may have been recorded or commemorated by using videotape or pictures. So I was not around when my grandmother's son, my uncle, passed away in 1956. It was before my birth. He was 14 years old. But I share his story and what happened to him with my children and with others. Just because I was not present at the time does not mean that what I share isn't true. The event is also recorded in historical accounts and historical registers and records so that it can be verified. So it was in a local news article. His obituary could be found and what happened that day. And then, of course, the county has a death registry, and the state of Florida has that in their records. So my great-great-grandchildren will only know of my uncle's story really through oral tradition, being passed down by mouth. If they want to research his life and death, they could actually find the records. So they could find about his life and death in whatever records were there to verify. They wouldn't get a real snapshot of the events of the day that his death occurred, but they could find out that, yes, he was born, yes, he died, maybe a little bit if they could find the newspaper article. But truly, if the records office burns down, or the news article archives are inaccessible because now everything's on digital. And, you know, we know that, how many of you guys have ever tried to access something and the records have been corrupted? And you're like, oh, I totally had so much important information in that flash drive. What do you mean my flash drive is corrupted? You know, that happens. So the only way that that information would be available to anybody would be through oral tradition or the writing down of it through family. So I do a lot of journaling to pass down to my children. So they will find out about many things long after I'm gone that maybe they didn't know or recall through those records. Well, the Bible is actually an historical text as well as it is a spiritual text. There's a lot of ancient history held within it. It's a rich resource for many things, including how people heard from God and how they primed themselves for their encounters with God. As we recall the text that we read from when Cornelius encountered the angel of the Lord in a vision, let's look at some things that we know about Cornelius. Now, interestingly enough, we really don't hear a lot about Cornelius in the scriptures. Basically, in Acts is where we get our information. And there's a lot to glean just from the text that we read this evening. So we know from that text that he was a Gentile, and we know this because only Gentiles could serve in the Italian regiment. Jews did not serve in the Italian regiment. So we know that he and his family were devout and God-fearing. We know that he was an influential leader, evident in the fact that his family was, they were all believers, and his position as a centurion. We know that he gave generously to the poor. We know he prayed to God regularly. We know he was respected among Jews, which is pretty significant to note, because he was a Gentile. Jews didn't associate with Gentiles, and yet he was respected among the Jews. So that says a little bit about the character of Cornelius. He wanted to know all that he could about the faith established by Jesus through Peter, in and through Peter. We know that he believed God was an observer of all that man did and had an interest in it. And we know that from his statement when he says, "We are all here in the sight of God when Peter comes." So he's referring that God is watching what we're doing and cares about what we're doing. So speak to us, Peter. He believed that God spoke through his disciples and gave revelations to them. And this is translated in the Greek text. So that is lost on the English text, but in Greek, that's also communicated very well. We also know that Cornelius recognized the ordained authority that Peter had as declared by Jesus. So now let's look at some things we know about Peter in relation to his faith. We know a lot more about Peter because there's a lot more writings about Peter. So we can kind of get a better snapshot of him. We know that he was an outspoken Jewish disciple who testified that he came to realize Jesus as the Christ, as the true, the one and true Messiah. We know that Peter knew Jesus personally when Jesus was on earth. We know that he had his own challenges understanding the ways of Christ, but he was obedient. We know that he was devout and God-fearing. He was a pillar of the church, or is a pillar of the church. He was a witness to the transfiguration. He walked on water. He defended Jesus often and denied him three times. We know he was a witness to Jesus' post-resurrection appearances. Peter prayed often. He also was an influential leader. And we know that he served the church unto death. He suffered and was eventually martyred for his faith. And many of you probably know how he was martyred. But it's interesting to me that Peter was martyred and he was also crucified. And at his crucifixion, he said, I'm not worthy to be crucified in the same manner that my Savior was. And so he was crucified upside down. So he suffered for his faith. So served us, the church, unto death. Now, as we read some of those things, I wanted to ask if you had noted any common denominators or similarities between Cornelius and Peter. Let's look at those similarities. They're both fully subjected to God's authority. They are both God-fearing disciples. They are both influential. They're both servants. They both pray often. They are both respected among their peers, indicating a moral condition because of who their peers were. And they were both in dedicated solitary prayer when the visions occurred. Now, there are also more individualized factors that reveal that each one of these men had a really close walk with Christ. We just reviewed written accounts of the condition of Cornelius and Peter, who hear from God in visions. And these specifications might help us as we try to get primed to hear from God. Here are a few questions to help us with our personal assessment of trying to determine where we are. How primed are we? Are we primed? Do we need to do a little bit more sharpening on ourselves? So some questions to ask are, how many common denominators do we have with Cornelius and Peter? What about the individual specifications of our own that get us primed to hear God's voice? For example, our spiritual gifts. Do we know what they are? Are they active? Are they being nurtured? What about acts of service to God and to others? If you remember in the text, Cornelius was told that his gifts to the poor were presented to God as an offering. Personality traits, what about those? What about our character? How about our encounters with Christ? Many of us have a calling of something specific that we're aware of. These are just some of those things that we can help identify our condition, help us identify our condition of whether or not we're primed. Are these things active and ready for us to receive God's messages? Another question is, do we ask God for his communication and prime ourselves for it? So do we say, God, I want to hear from you. I want you to speak to me, Lord. I want you to speak to me. I want you to speak to me in prayer. I'm here with you. During that prayer time, are you crying out to him? How about when you're reading his word? Lord, speak to me. Make this text come alive. I know you're working towards working something out. You want me to work something out through this message. Are you asking him, show me yourself in visions, in dreams at night? I want to spend every moment with you. Reveal yourself to me. Have we talked with people about their experiences about hearing from God? Do we talk to one another? We sharpen each other. Iron sharpens iron, and that's what we do as believers. What's God saying to you? What did you hear from God today? Every single day, he's speaking to each of us. So we can spur each other on and encourage one another. Once you begin researching this matter, you quickly find out that you won't be alive long enough to attain all the recorded and shared experiences of people hearing from God. The magnitude of this phenomena is immeasurable. I mean, you could just spend every day researching and finding all these testimonies about people encountering God and hearing from God. Another aspect that's really important as we do this personal assessment is that Peter and Cornelius had an active relationship with Christ. They spent time with him. They nurtured their relationship with him, which had a significant effect on their condition and readiness to hear from God. How can we hear something or receive messages from people that we don't spend time with? Honestly, we can't. It's impossible. Also, another thing to look at is the more we know people, the better we can receive those messages clearly. The truth is that people communicate many things without saying a single word. An excellent example of this is love. Love is often communicated without a single word being spoken. My children and husband are all very different, and they express themselves differently. The more I know them, the better I receive their messages. I'm sure you guys are in a family dynamic of some sort. Can you not read the attitude of someone, right? They don't have to say a word, but they come in and they put their hands on their hips and they look at you. They don't have to say a word. Or they're smiling and they're so excited to see you and they don't have to say a word. You have received that message very clearly. Well, that really makes a difference in the way we receive messages clearly. My husband, Bob, I don't know how many of you guys have gone through the Love Language book. I love that book. It really helps you understand how people communicate and express love. My husband, his love language is touch and acts of service. And so he doesn't use a lot of words to express love. He loves to talk. He's a very social person, but not when it comes to love. Like, he's not mushy-gushy, and he's not going to, like, write me these poems. That's not just how he is at all. But since I know that, I see that he, through his acts of service, is constantly communicating his love for me and our family. So he goes to work, he works hard, he uses all of his talents and gifts to help our family. He also is always, he's holding my hand or he's leaning up against me. And that's to let me know that he's present in love with me. And he does that with the family as well. So that's really important that we understand the person that we're communicating with so that we can receive those messages clearly. I'm wordy. You probably would have never guessed that, right? I like words. And my husband, that's not how he expresses love. So if I was waiting for him to express that through words, I might be really insecure in my relationship with my husband. I might think that, oh, maybe he doesn't love me. He doesn't tell me all the time. He's not real gushy-mushy. He doesn't write me poems. You know, see, there's other people, and they're so great with words, and that's not how he expresses himself. But I am completely secure in his love for me because I know him. I spend time with him, and I make it a point to know him well. So in regards to relationship, that's really, really important to know who we're communicating with. It prevents miscommunication. There's another way that I want to look at to silently communicate, and that's through creation. So I asked Britlin permission to share this with you because this spoke to me, and I know that you'll be able to receive this illustration well through this just this thing I'm going to share. So recently, Britlin, who is the daughter of Cameron and Devon Lee here, she is a gifted artist, and she was working on a gift for a friend. So she was making him a painting for his birthday. So this friend that she has is a seeker. He's not a believer, and she's been doing Bible study with him. So as she was making this painting, she was very intentional about the details of this painting. She expressed just naturally some of her personality in it. So, of course, she chose her favorite color blends, and she chose some of her favorite night lights like the moon, and she chose some of her favorite flowers. But she also wanted to communicate somehow in this painting that Jesus loves this friend. And so she strategically placed a cross in the painting. When you look at the painting, you're immediately drawn to the cross, which prompts you to begin to look around at the surroundings of the cross for hints of the message that's being communicated. Her beautiful creation tells quite a story. It tells us a story about Britlin. It tells a little bit about who she is. You can see her favorite colors and some of her favorite things in it. You can tell that she has a love for Christ and a faith in him, and she cares for her friend and his soul. It also tells a story about Jesus. His story is expressed within the creation through the cross. And there's a story about her friend in this painting. It communicates that he's loved and cared for. Now, without doing research, and without having a relationship with Britland and knowing what the cross represents, I might just look at this painting and think, it's a painting. I definitely would not know that it was communicating powerful love and care. It would be a piece of art that I would admire and enjoy looking at. All around us, God is communicating to us through his creation. Are we primed to receive what he is telling us? So many messages from God are sent to us daily. I can't help but wonder how many are being received. What's the reception stats? I bet you it's not what it's supposed to be. As I was preparing for tonight's message, I was challenged and inspired to do more priming of my own. The busyness of this world, which is the enemy's platform, successfully gains my focus often, and I know that I am missing out on a lot of what God wants to tell me and to share with others. I'm missing out with every missed message that he sends, and others are missing out on what I miss out. Because just like when my husband effectively communicates his love for me, it builds me up, makes me feel confidence, and I'm happy, and I share that. It's the same thing when God communicates to us. It builds us up. It encourages us. It lifts us up to a place that we couldn't be on our own, and we share that confidence and that love with a world who needs it. If we were primed and stayed primed, we would hear from God all day, every day, even in our dreams. So my hope and my prayer for all of us is to be constantly hearing from our God who loves us so graciously. Let's pray, shall we? Lord, I confess that I don't always bend myself to you, that I get distracted by things of this world, Lord. I don't want to do that anymore. I want to constantly hear from you. I want to receive all the things that you want to give me, Lord. Even in the challenges of life, Lord, there is a great message that you have for me, Lord. You have effectively communicated that in this world there will be trouble. But that is not what your plan is for our life. You do not leave us there, Lord. You deliver us victoriously through your love and grace, Lord. And so I just pray, Lord, that that would minister to us and speak to each and every one of us every single day. It will carry us through the trials of life, Lord, and we will be able to share a powerful love that we can't fully comprehend, Jesus. We love you. We surrender our hearts, our lives, and our spirits to you, Jesus. In your precious name, we pray these things. Amen.
Let's stand for the benediction. May our God find us ready to hear his call. May we remember that the call to service is a call to prepare, and may we be primed and ready for his work when he reveals his plan to us. Go in peace.